Why am I nervous? Let's see, 1,300 rounds per minute. This is ridiculous. Oh my God. Holy shit, that was awesome. Can I have another, please, sir?
We got our auto maxim that is at 1,300 rounds per minute.
I definitely just got brass bukkake. But it was awesome.
Hey guys, James with TFBTV. We are here in the basement, in the Batcave of SilencerCo. One of the coolest places I think I've ever been. We've got quite a selection behind us, as you guys can see. I'm here with Jake. Jake, introduce yourself. Let everybody know who you are.
So I'm Jake Turnblom. I'm a design engineer at SilencerCo. I've been here about 5 years and jumped in about halfway through this Maxim 9 project.
So when I came on board. That's what we're here to talk about. That's perfect. You're the guy to talk to about it, because we want to talk about the Maxim 9. This is one of the more unusual, one of the coolest guns that's out there on the market today. What is the Maxim 9?
So the Maxim 9 is an integrally suppressed handgun. So instead of having a separate firearm that you put a silencer on, it's just one piece.
Right.
The gun is just quiet instead of having to make it quiet or not.
What is so special about the Maxim 9? Walk us through the features before we get into it. So what can I do with this?
So as far as the mechanism goes, the primary benefit of the Maxim 9 is it has a fixed barrel. Most handguns in general do not have a fixed barrel. It's part of the delay mechanism. So whether the barrel comes back a certain way before unlocking, or most commonly you have a tilting barrel recoil operated like a Glock or an M&P, where the barrel actually moves, comes back, drops, and that's your delay. But the problem with that when you're running a suppressor is a suppressor basically adds weight to the barrel. So when you add weight to the barrel, that kind of just throws off your whole delay mechanism, which is why we need to use a piston or a booster.
Or a Nielsen device. Yeah. And then you get more recoil and it's more parts.
Yep, you got more parts. It's less, you typically lose a little bit of accuracy unless you make sure everything's like really nicely lubed all the time. And so it just, you're adding moving parts to moving parts, which it works. But it's not as reliable or robust as having just a fixed barrel. So we wanted to put the delay somewhere else. Leave the barrel alone, leave that completely rigid, and we're eliminating a set of moving parts, and we're going to put the delay somewhere else. So that's essentially how it started.
For my gun nerds out there who care about delay mechanisms, mm-hmm. How are we doing it with this?
With the Maxim 9, so we call it a delay wing. I don't know if we'll be able to see this from here, but we've got this little wing right here that has a little kind of round end on it. And if you look at the barrel block here, you can see that little void.
Okay.
So essentially, that little ball of that delay wing sits in that when the outer slide is closed, and we have an inner and an outer slide.
Okay.
So essentially what happens is when this is together and the slide is closed, you have basically a wedged part on the outer slide pushing that into that inner slide. So this is kind of like a one-sided roller delay.
That's just what I was about to say. I didn't want to interrupt you, but I'm like, this is like basically like an MP5, like a one-sided MP5 roller delay.
Yeah. So as you're firing, your casing tries to push back on the breech face. That pushes the outer slide backwards, but it can't move backwards because it's pushing on this tapered part of the outer slide. So essentially, you start pushing here, but it's going to have to throw the outer slide back past it faster than it's moving before that opens up.
Sure.
So that's how our delay works.
So what calibers is it coming in right now?
So just 9mm.
Okay.
Just the most common standard one.
Sure. Ever. Any plans to do 45 or anything else?
Not in the near future. We
really need to.
We have dabbled. We've got some other prototypes. We've actually kind of gone more this route to this non-NFA Maxim 9.
But yeah, so we're talking, what, 15 plus 1, 9mm semi-automatic handgun?
Yeah, so it uses your standard Glock 17 magazines.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
Yeah,
it takes Glock mag. So 17 round.
Yep.
And flush fit?
Yep, 17 plus 1.
Okay, yeah. What are we talking about in terms of performance? What kind of performance am I going to get out of a Maxim 9 versus, say, taking a Glock 17 and suppressing it?
About the same. It sounds a little bit better to the ear. You have just kind of a different sound profile from it, largely because you're eliminating a bunch of moving parts. To me, when I shoot a Maxim 9, it sounds like much more of a poof versus a Glock 19, where you have that plus a lot of clacking and movement, and it just kind of feels bumpy. So it's just really smooth. But as far as decibels, when you have it in the short configuration like the one in your hand, the intent there is to protect, be a little more kind of due to use, protect your hearing with virtually all 9mm ammunition and keep it below a pain threshold.
Sure.
And then the long ones, like if you actually if you actually want to be quiet.
And that's funny because I was going to bring up this exact same thing. Like I look at this and I see like the SilencerCo Salvo. Like this is similar where it's like I can configure it and I can take it down. I can add more. So if I wanted to be quieter, it's going to be bigger. It's going to be heavier. Longer, but it's going to be quieter. Or I can go with like a shorter version if, you know, I want to be a little more mobile.
Yeah, that's actually an interesting thing to mention because the architecture of the silencer portion is based off the Salvo. I mean, that's a lot of stuff we do here, whether it's products we release or don't release. Some of those lessons or things that work or don't work kind of carry over to unsuspected products later.
Sure.
So yeah, it's exactly like the Salvo. You got tongue and groove, basically aligning each section, and then you've got the two tie rods in the front keeping the whole thing together.
Whose idea was this? When did this start?
Before my time. So the president of SilencerCo, one of the founders, Jonathan Schultz, this was his initiative to start on this project.
How long ago?
Man, at this point, 8 or 9 years ago.
Talk to me about some challenges you ran into. Talk to me about the R&D. Like, how did you guys figure out that this was the way to go?
Well, with the suppressor part, that was just a lot of trial and error. We're doing like an offset design like this. Obviously, it's not round like most suppressors, and we have some experience doing that between the Osprey and the Salvo, so we kind of know some stuff, right? But we wanted to make it obviously as manufacturable as possible, so we tested a lot of different stuff. We did a lot of monocore designs and just a lot of high-speed video. We'd basically take like a cut a monocore out of a block of aluminum and then thread and tap holes and put a fat piece of plexiglass over it and, you know, bolt it down, and then we could see in the high-speed camera, watch how our explosion is propagating through it. So we did a lot of that. We did a lot of monocore designs. We did some baffle stack designs.
It's funny. I'm screwing around here in the gun room. I am like, what in the sweet hell is this thing?
Yeah, so.
But this has something to do with the Maxim 9.
Right, yeah. So the purpose of this is we basically just put a little 9mm plug on the end piece there of the proper barrel length. So this is essentially just became our 9mm bolt gun.
This is a bolt action 9mm like from the Philippines.
Yeah, I mean we use what we can get, you know.
What were you doing with this? Like, how did this have anything to do with the Maxim?
So it's not too hard to make a suppressor for a bolt gun and test it and see how it's doing, but when you're trying to balance a suppressor with a mechanical action with a certain amount of delay, it's like, man, you're trying to chase two things at once. So this was, well,
this was variable isolation.
Yes, this exactly. It's like, well, let's get the suppressor to be awesome first, because this is the footprint we have to fit it in. This is how heavy and big and quiet it needs to be, all that stuff, right? So it's like, we know what this, how the action is going to work generally, but before we kind of tune those angles and dial it in, like, let's make the best suppressor we can without that corrupting like what we're trying to learn, right? So yeah, we just put our suppressor prototypes, we'd make them mount to this, and then we'd just shoot like a bolt gun, get some sound data, and as soon as we got the suppressor where we wanted it to, then it's like that, and then at that point we can combine it with the action. And
this is what we started with, right?
Yeah, that was the first one that we showed to the public.
It's a Smith & Wesson M&P, like a butchered Smith & Wesson M&P frame, and then you guys have something, it looks just like a monocore, just one piece suppressor on the front.
Yeah, so that one's actually, it is a baffle stack, but it's welded together. Mm-hmm. So it's very monolithic, I guess you could say at this point. Yeah. But yeah, we actually started on the Beretta, and the idea to try to get some delay instead of using, before we got to what we call our wing delay, the first attempt was to actually, can we make the hammer heavy enough and with enough stout enough that we could actually just rely on resetting the hammer as a delay? So we started on the Beretta frame. That didn't exactly pan out how we wanted. And then
it would also have to be double action only for that to work too, right?
I mean, yeah, if you're relying on the
hammer, that would suck.
Yeah.
Know, like nobody wants that. So
you could have a hump that it has to like ride over or something, you know what I mean? But
okay, so you started like with a Beretta 92, and you can kind of see the framework here. And then you guys moved to the M&P. Then what was the next step? When did that happen?
Well, the M&P, I think for a little while there, it was actually kind of on the table that that was going to be what we sell. But as time went on, we were modifying M&P frames, and it didn't make sense to buy a bunch of M&Ps to strip everything off and use the frames, mm-hmm. or see if Smith & Wesson wanted to provide them or whatever. But yeah, just as we were optimizing everything, trying to get the delay to work best, make the gun reliable, make it tough, robust, safe, all that stuff. We just kind of got to a point where it was like, we just need to make our own grip. Like, right. We need to make our own frame that accommodates everything. And might be, you know, personal opinion, this looks kind of goofy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not that this but a little less goofy.
Yeah, right? I know, but I mean, still, this is like got Judge Dredd vibes.
Yeah, a little.
Yeah, this is like whatever, you know, all my sci-fi dudes are going to roast me. It's like a lawgiver. I think it certainly looks cooler. I mean, it's almost like this is like the prison shank version of this. You know what I mean? You know, like it looks less sophisticated. So this was the next evolution. Mm-hmm. I guess you guys, are you making the frames in-house?
So we don't do plastic injection molding here, mm-hmm. But these are glass-filled nylon that we do outsource the process, but we get the grips in here.
Uh-huh.
And you have a couple MIM parts in there, but the vast majority, everything machined, assembly, all that happens in-house. Oh, and the sights, those are kind of an interesting story too. The sights we don't make here, but that was actually kind of a problem we had to solve because most tritium sights, we wanted night sights. That was part of our initial spec. We wanted night sights. But the tritium vials that are held into virtually all the night sights out there are held in with an adhesive,
uh-huh.
which isn't necessarily a bad thing. But on our front sight, it's on a suppressor. It's right on the suppressor. It gets really hot.
Yeah.
So we ended up basically burning the adhesive off and losing our tritium vials many times.
Sure.
So we ended up working with a company and found an alternative way to hold the tritium vials in, which these
the
are actually pinned
roll
in.
Pin, the yep. tiniest roll pin.
So you've got basically, it can't exit out the backside. So you put your tritium vial in, pin it.
It's like you
and
guys
now
had
can't
the
go
little
anywhere.
like tactical Keebler elves making the tiniest roll pins in the world
yep.
for use in your front sight. That's actually really clever. So if I want a Maxim 9, how much is it going to cost me?
1500 MSRP.
And it's the same process as getting a silencer, more
yep.
or less, right?
Yeah, effectively you have two serial numbers, kind of like an MP5, even though it is an integral and it's architecturally supposed to be one thing, just because of how things work around here.
Yeah,
we have
gotta,
a separate serial number for the silencer, separate serial number for the firearm portion.
Okay, this has really been a labor of love for you guys, and you've put a lot of thought into it. So that was, I wanted to kind of tell that story. Where is the Maxim 9 going from here?
Oh, we're still offering, we're still selling it. People love them. But yeah, you've buy one, it comes with the baffles and the long configuration and a rod kit, so you can just put it in the short configuration straight out of the box. From here, we're just essentially dialing things in, improving, constant improvements like anything. We learn over time, and we've designed a new trigger that we'll be rolling out with. The current plan is to roll that out with the Maxim 9 non-NFA. So it's kind of funny, with the Maxim 9, the whole intent was to build an integral 9mm handgun.
Mm-hmm.
But the funny thing is, all the problems we solved to do that, we kind of got to a point where we thought, well, if it didn't have a suppressor on it, this is like the most badass silencer host ever.
Yeah.
Like, one thing that might kind of go unnoticed is you actually look at the sight profile, how it kind of dips and comes
uh-huh.
up. So where the barrel is on here, you could put virtually any, even the bigger round uh-huh. pistol silencers,
yeah.
and it'll see over the top.
Oh, no shit. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so you've already got
they're
just
already
like
raised sights.
Yeah, you're by nature,
like it, but yeah,
and
yeah.
you don't have a big, you know,
exactly.
snag point
yeah,
on
it's
there.
More aesthetically pleasing and more functional.
Yeah, yeah, so you've got that, and then another aspect is if you look at the slide, you've got a little downward angle right there,
mm-hmm.
and what that does is it actually jets any debris that comes back, instead of coming straight at your eyes when you're sighting in, it actually kind of acts as a gate that blows it down. So if you actually shoot a lot, you'll actually get some crap on
uh-huh.
your wrists instead of your eyes.
Uh-huh.
So that actually protects the shooter from any blowback from suppressing.
And so that has led to this. This is the Maxim 9, what you're calling it, the non-NFA?
Yep.
Is that what you're calling it?
Yep.
And what does this one set me back? I mean, you were looking at probably half by 28, right? Half
yep.
by 28 threaded, fixed barrel using your wing delay blowback, cut for what, RMR?
So plate system, we have just a plate system.
Okay.
Plate 1, 2, 3, 4 to cover all the basic stuff. Oh, and another thing too is with your RMR placement, it doesn't reciprocate with your slide.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah, like an island almost.
Yeah,
like a, yeah, yeah.
It's like having
got
a
it.
6-second mount or something
yeah,
that's just
yeah.
kind of built into it.
Okay, and so if I want what you guys say is, and what very well could be the best 9mm suppressor host pistol-wise, what does this set me back?
Don't know yet. Yeah, so
this one's not out yet.
No, it's not. I mean, we've done a lot of work on it. It's pretty deep into its development. But we're kind of on a standstill right now, which is frustrating to me. I mean, I'm not a sales guy, a production guy, so I'm sure others don't have the frustration I do, but it's like, we're so close, I just wanna start selling this thing, you know? It's kick ass.
Well, Jake, I really appreciate you walking me through all this. This is a story that I wanted to bring to everybody out there, TFBTV viewers. I know that they're gonna be appreciative. Guys, thanks a ton for watching. Thank you to SilencerCo for hosting us in this lovely establishment.
Happy
Jake, thanks again to you guys. Stay tuned. We're bringing you more from SilencerCo.